This is the Page Publishing Book Club. How are you? How are you doing, Rob Barrett? I'm your host, Alice Stockton Rossini. Happy March! Come on, spring! Come on, I can feel it. I can't wait, because summer's right behind it. And I'm not just talking about weather. Spring into action, people. It's time. Spring into action with your life, your story, your book. We've talked about this how many times? How some first-time authors are blessed by life experiences with an incredible story to tell? Well, we're starting off with one of them. Her name is Satrice. She's been living in Southeast Asia for over 20 years, and there she built a furniture business in the jungle. I'm not kidding. And then, well, life happened and she's back in the States telling her story. The name of her book is Distraction. Nice name, Satrice.
Well, thank you.
Yeah, it's very pretty.
The book is a trilogy, and the first chapter ends in a cliffhanger about romance. So that was kind of the way we decided to go with just my first name.
All right.
I've been living overseas for the last 24 years. And a turn of circumstances, my husband and I were yanked back to the United States, and I had to sell my big, very successful business. I've worked my entire life, and I find myself here not knowing what to do. So I started writing my memoirs. Every bit of this true.
Wow.
Is true. I lived in the jungle for 18 years.
How did you end up living in the jungle and with a furniture business?
My father, who I was very close to and had raised me, got cancer and died. And I had a double engineering degree, and I was working like 100, 115 hours a week. And I decided if I kept on that this pace of life, I would end up dying like my father did. So after he died, I found myself all alone in the world and not sure what to do. And I went to Bali in 1992 to just go heal. After the first month in Bali, I'm like, this is where I belong. And I at the time, I had a very successful job. And I started traveling around Bali trying to find a way to make a living so I wouldn't expire all of my savings. And I found myself in the depths of the mahogany and teak forest, the only place in the world where it was still indigenous. And it happened to be the best carvers in the world. And I just suddenly had a vision. It was like the hand of God just put his hand on my shoulder, and I just knew what I had to do. I was going to create beautiful furniture designs that the Westerners would like and export them around the world.
Wow. So did you give work to these indigenous people, these carvers?
I had 493 people working for me inside the factory, and about another 500 people working outside the factory. And these people basically became my family. I knew every last one of them by name. I basically paid for their first transportation, their motorcycle. I paid for their weddings. I paid for their children to be born. I paid for their grandparents in the hospital. They became my entire life.
That's amazing. What kind of a life is it there? Do they have modern convenience? I mean, did you have running water?
That time I had 300 watts of electricity. This is right on the equator, so it's very hot. And so for almost 4 years, I lived without air conditioning and without hot water. Basically, a couple 20-watt light bulbs, a little bitty fridge, and a little CD player, and a fax machine. It was my lifeline to the world. I lived there 15 years doing just that life, growing it and growing it. I bought a yacht. I hired a crew. I spent all of my spare time going through the waters of Southeast Asia, exploring and just helping the people. And 15 years later, in a chance meeting in a Dallas-Fort Worth airport, I meet a man that follows me all the way to Indonesia to get to know me better.
Wow.
He's there first when he tries to meet me. I have nothing to do with him. I'm not meeting a man from America. I might end up there one day. I'm an Asian woman in my mind.
Right.
So where it was love at first sight for him, he had a lot of winning me over to do.
Right.
He comes all the way to Indonesia and puts on the most fantasy first perfect date. sets me up in a suite with flowers and love music and hand delivers crystal glasses from America and champagne. And the date ends up going on almost a week. Then we go to Singapore. But then at that point, I say goodbye. And I had never really expected to see him again.
All right. So, Therese, I'm going to stop you right there because you've written several books, as you said in the beginning. And we want people to read them to find out where your romance ends up, where you end up, and what happens in this real-life jungle story. Thank you so much. Like Therese, Charles Rack has lived an unconventional life that's given him a wealth of experiences for him to draw on to make for a really interesting story. He's the guy you might see drawing characters on a city street anywhere on the planet. The name of his book is The Bahaca. Charles.
Yes. That is the Portuguese word for tent.
Okay.
And you see that word printed all over Natal, Brazil, where I live. It's the only home I know, really, my girlfriend's home. It's spelled B-A-R-R-A-C-A. So I Americanized it so people wouldn't have difficulty, because they don't pronounce R's in Brazil.
Right. So tell me about this unconventional lifestyle you write about.
In other words, I'm not afraid to sleep in the car. I'm not afraid to travel wherever and whenever I want. If I need money, I walk into a bar and start sketching somebody and entertain them. And then I get money for doing that, and I can go on. I've never been that concerned about money, so that's how I've made it. And I've been a creative person all my life, a holistic thinker. And my girlfriend has a problem with it, so she helped me resolve my life situation, which I'm in the process of doing right now. I thought I can at least paint some pictures and write a book, and maybe I can make something out of that.
Okay, so have you ever had like a legit job?
Well, I've had a job being a caricature artist, but my last legitimate job was driving a cab when I was in my 20s, early 20s, I'd say.
So you've been able to support yourself through your art.
Yes.
That's great. Good for you. Not many people can say that.
I think it's a great way to make a living. Sometimes the money's pretty good.
Yeah, but you just don't know when.
Well, that's right, but you can't be afraid of that. I mean, I'm just confident in my abilities.
Now, your book starts with, you know, you're a kid in school drawing pictures, and you get this opportunity to go and visit a sister's home in West Africa. And that kind of inspires you. And when you come back, you're drawing and you're getting bad grades and getting sent to the principal's office. And the principal decides to give you a break and says, if you can draw a picture of him, everything's going to work out for you.
Exactly. So I did what I was told. He was happy with it, and it encouraged me to try it again over and over until I decided to make it my life work, is to not only draw caricatures, but to paint pictures of scenery and portraits and so forth.
And you've traveled around the world doing this.
I've gotten close. I do special events. I do county fairs, and I've gotten into target marketing lately. I really enjoyed the Northwest, Idaho, Montana, Wyoming, because those people have a very high suicide rate, lots of divorce, and a lot of alcoholism. And they really need me. They need a few laughs. And so I'm happy to go there.
Did you ever marry or have children?
Yes. I married a Canadian woman, had a son, who is into theater in New York.
And you're in Vermont now.
Yes, I work at the Jackson Gore Resort at Okemo Mountain.
And then you can just sell your book because you're going to all these different places anyway.
Exactly. I want to order some more books soon so I can sell them at the ski lodge where I'm doing caricatures of the children of these wealthy skiers that come up every weekend and vacations.
Wow, Charles, you got a good thing going there, buddy.
It was on my mind. It was on my mind to write this book and to find a publisher. And I was driving around south of Santa Fe through a place called Cerrillos in New Mexico. And I heard the advertisement on the radio, and I stopped and jotted it down. I mean, I took advantage. I seized the opportunity to contact Page Publishing and submitted my manuscript, and it was accepted.
Excellent, Charles. We'll keep on trucking, buddy. Maybe I'll run into you drawing pictures in a city somewhere one of these days. Gary McIlvaine was so captivated when his 5-year-old son won a goldfish at his first kindergarten carnival. He had to write about it. The name of his book, Don't Feed the Fish French Fries. Gary.
Yes, it was his story. We started, it was kind of funny as it was kind of unfolding. We kind of started chopping it down and then wrote it up, and then a good friend of ours, who's a really good artist, who did the artwork for us, that's in the book.
That's great. What happened? Tell me the story.
Cooper, do you want to tell some of the story?
Oh, Cooper's there?
Yes, he is here with me.
Oh, I'm so excited. Hi, Cooper.
Hi. It all started when I went into the green pond, and I saw where people won the fish games, and I said, let's go on the hayride first so I can get with my friend James. I haven't been with him in a while. So we went on that. It was outside. It was really fast, like 55 kilometers or miles. Some people left the hats that they had. They had to go back and get them. But mostly it was fun.
Okay.
We went to Wendy's, and I said, why don't we feed the fish the french fries if it's hungry? And Daddy and Mama was like, no, fish don't eat french fries. They eat fish food. So I'm like, why? Why not? It's still food. And they're like, no, they have to have fish food. It's not, french fries aren't a type of food for fish. I'm like, oh, okay.
What do fish not have? Teeth. Yeah, they don't have any teeth. Right?
They can't break that stuff down. Cooper, how old are you now?
Yeah,
8.
Yep, in second grade.
Did you help write the book?
Yes.
Is there a moral to the story?
More of it is kind of just the account of it, and then also we thought it'd be a great way for especially preschool kids that are nervous about kindergarten and starting kindergarten and being away from home that much for the first time, some of the fun stuff they get to do, and looking, being able to look forward to that.
Yeah, because you don't realize how much fun it is until you get there. You mentioned the hayrides and the games and the ponies, and that all happens at school.
Yes, it's all at the school, and some of it's inside, some's outside. Of course, the hayride and ponies would be outside, but yeah, it's a pretty big deal. It goes for 2 or 3 hours, and we have several kids come through. It's a pretty big fundraiser for the school that they do, and it's a lot of fun. All the teachers participate throughout the different pods where the classrooms are, and set up games and different things for the kids. So they get to see teachers throughout it.
So now what, Cooper?
Yeah, it just got available online, and we've ordered some copies also for people where we go to church with, and Miss Alicia that did all the drawings, we go to church with her. So several people were wanting a copy of the book, and we'll read it. And there's a couple pediatricians, I think, is going to put them in their waiting rooms and things. So it's kind of neat.
That's really nice. Are you guys going to keep writing together? Are you going to be a team now?
If the opportunity comes up with something else, yeah. We just talked about that a few minutes ago, if you want to do another one sometime. But it's time-consuming, and the time frame of getting it through with publication and everything. So we'll give this one probably a little bit of time, and then he won another goldfish and another one. So we may do something else or some different pets or different things, but we'll see.
Great job, guys. Nice teamwork. All right, we have got to take a quick break, but we are coming right back. So don't go anywhere. This is the Page Publishing Book Club.
Have you written a book and want to get it published? Then now's the time to call Page Publishing at 800-204-6099 and do it immediately. You see, they're looking for authors of all types of books. And unlike most publishers, Page Publishing will take the time to review most of the books submitted to them. And they'll even give you their feedback. And if they like what they read, Page Publishing will get your book into bookstores and for sale online at Amazon, the Apple iTunes Store, and other outlets. They'll handle everything. Copyright protection, printing, cover art, publicity, and editing. So if you've written a novel, a children's book, a cookbook, inspirational work, a book of poetry, or biography, and want to get it published, then you need to call Page Publishing and do it immediately. Call 800-204-6099 now for your free author submission kit. Your road to fame and fortune could very well start with this simple phone call. For your free author submission kit, call Page Publishing at 800-204-6099.
Welcome back to the Page Publishing Book Club. I'm your host, Alice Stockton Rossini. Rafael Reyes Granger Jr. has never seen a UFO in his life, but he is fascinated enough by them to compile a book by the name of 11 of the Scariest UFO Incidents Worldwide. Raphael.
It's like a compendium of different stories. I learned how to take notes from the History Channel, and but 2 or 3 years ago was getting video and verbal stories on different incidents around the world. So I started taking notes in a notebook. I took notes for a whole year, and so I figured, well, I might as well. I was had writing a book in the back of the mind with some pictures and photos and whatnot to stimulate the reader's interest, you know. So that's what I did.
All right. So where did you get these incidents? How did you compile your information?
Well, I watched the History Channel, and I wrote notes as fast as I could. And then when I decided to do the book, I searched other articles written, like Wikipedia. They did a good job of writing up these incidents. And when I went to find out, get copyright permission on the various photographs that I have in the book,
right,
they wouldn't take any money. So I said, well, can I donate? And I donated $285, you know, for about 7 pictures or photos. Google Images, okay. Google Images.
So what are you hoping to do with this book? Are you hoping to revive the conversation about UFOs?
No, I'm just going to add more stories, but I want to try to explain how the UFOs travel through wormholes in space, because they're traveling, they're moving faster than a light year, you know,
right,
than the speed of light. They figured out a way to do this. And what they do is they go through wormholes. But, you know, there's a lot of stuff out there, but it's all in pieces all over the place. And,
right.
I spent a lot of time in the library looking at various books on UFOs, and there's not, wasn't really like one book that had a whole bunch of incidents and like crashes and incidents like Koyami. That's a big one that people don't know about. That was just across the border of the Rio Grande River and United States and Mexico, and there were creatures, there were photos of bodies from the crash. That is as big as Roswell, but it's hardly ever mentioned.
So you wanted to put all this information in one spot. I'm looking forward to the next 11 of the Scariest UFO Incidents Worldwide.
Well, actually, the next one's going to start with the scariest one of all, or not, Commander Admiral Byrd, a relative of the discoverer of the North Pole.
Mm-hmm.
He led a battalion of 6,000 men and equipment, guns, tanks, went down to Antarctica and actually landed down there and to clean out the Nazis that were left there from World War II. They were still, they had an active base there. And so the U.S. Army encountered a UFO, which the U.S. forces tried to shoot it down from the sky, and they couldn't do it. Because the UFO fired back, and they were under such heavy fire that the U.S. forces, before they could get the job done with the Nazis, they turned their tail and ran home. They took off and went home because the UFO was helping the Germans keep their Nazi base.
So that's
the
in
US
your next
battalion.
Book.
No, it's never been written up anywhere. I don't even know how I found that one.
All right, Raphael. UFO enthusiasts are going to have a field day with this. I can see that coming. David Klipper recently retired and just wanted to try writing a book about two lonely U.S. Air Force members who volunteer for a potentially dangerous overseas mission where they have to pose as husband and wife. So I got to thinking, David, is there any truth in this?
Well, you know, it's like, say, for instance, something happens in your life, and then you just embellish it. So, yeah, so something did happen like that. But, you know, but I'm just, like, rewriting it the way I would have liked it to have turned out.
Okay, so what's it about?
Well, the Air Force were looking for 6 particular people, young people, that is, and they want them to go on a long mission, but a lot of the mission involves them posing as, you know, they're spying and doing surveillance and stuff like that. And so, you know, like the way we used to do it is that we would go to a country and we would just pretend to be tourists. And, you know, we would just go look around and take pictures and, you know, make notes and stuff like that. And nobody never asked us no questions. And I always thought that was odd because we would just go to all these places, you know, because we needed to find out about things. So I did that for like 2 years. But, you know, I just always had kept a journal of everything that happened. And I was in no way interested in writing a nonfiction story because that would take all the fun out of it. So, you know, in this way, I could have fun and embellish the whole story at the same time. They go to Asia and they have to work in 8 different countries because the United States government has made a contract with these countries to sell them this top secret satellite equipment. But, you know, they have to pave the way to make this all happen. You know, so in other words, their part-time job being spies, but their regular jobs are being bureaucrats. It's about a relationship because a young woman is writing the story about how her parents met. And the background story, everything that happens in the background story is true. So you could say it's a nice mixture of romance, historical fiction, and military fiction if people are interested in stuff like that. From the start, since a young girl is telling a story about her parents, they're doing this mission for 8 years, and this is all the things that happened to them while they're gone all this time. So that's what the story is mainly about, and of course, and how they met too. You will learn a lot about what it's like to serve in the military, difficulties and the sufferings that people go through because, you know, you live an unpredictable lifestyle. The unexpected things that might happen to you if you go live in another country and you never know what might happen with your life and stuff like that and the people that you meet. And, you know, you might make lifelong friendships or you might even get married because I married a woman that I met in South Korea. And, you know, I have my 2 children from her. So it's all these things that happen to them, you know, expected and unexpected.
Right.
That story had been fermenting in my mind for many years, and I had to put it together. It took me like 8 years to put it together because, like I say, well, I'm an amateur writer, but I just want to see what happens with this book.
All right, David, fair enough. Thanks for sharing. Finally, Lori has toyed with writing on and off, but now she can thank a mess in her closet for inspiring her to write every time, any place. Is that right, Lori?
I wanted to write when I was 17 and I saw Star Wars for the first time.
Uh-huh.
I thought it was the most exciting, you know, movie I'd ever been to. And I thought, man, it'd be great if I could create something this exciting. I did actually write something when I was 18 years old, and I sent it off, and it was accepted. But at 18, I was just, you know, too scared,
right,
really. So I didn't really get that one published. But then years later, you know, I was sitting in the bottom of my closet. It was pretty cluttered, and I was trying to decide what I wanted to read. You know, I had a stack of books I had never got to before. And it suddenly occurred to me after reading several of them that I could write better than what I was reading. And I thought, well, you know what? I can kind of mesh these all together and, you know, come up with a story.
So what's the story?
It takes place in the early 1700s when arranged marriages were still commonplace. Of course, the 2 participants weren't all that happy about it, you know, until they meet. And then, you know, the idea kind of grows on them then. And then by the time they start getting happy about it is when all the trouble breaks loose. There's somebody that's, you know, involved that she's kind of practicing witch.
She's a witch?
Yeah.
Okay.
And she kind of puts a spell and she sends her off into a different time and he has to find out what happens to her.
Like a different century?
Yeah, to our century.
Oh, the poor thing.
Yeah. And he has to find out what happens to her. And of course, he needs some help. And then he has to go and rescue her.
All right.
There's some unexpected things in there that you didn't really see. But you say, oh, okay, I see where she's going with this.
All right. Are you going to keep writing?
Oh, I've written 3 more after that. It's a series.
Have you read the Outlander books?
Yes, I watched, you know, the TV series too.
Yeah, yeah, that's what this reminds me of. She goes off.
Yeah, that's what my husband said. You know, when it first came on, he goes, "This reminds me of your novels." Yeah, it does.
Oh, Outlander reminds him of your novels.
Yeah, because he's read my novels, so, you know.
All right, are you going to keep writing?
Oh, I've written three more after that. It's a series.
Oh, it's a series. You've written three more already?
Oh, yeah.
All right, Lori, from the bottom of your closet to four novels. Not bad. Not bad at all. I think that about wraps up another edition of the Page Publishing Book Club. Thank you so much for being here, Rob Barrett. And thanks to all of our authors. But most of all, thanks to you. You're the most important, you know, because without listeners, what's the point? Right? Am I right, Rob? Getting a big nod over there. That's right. We need you. And you need us, right? To inspire you. Come on now. Come on. Spring's coming. You got to write that book. Let's go. Let's go. No more excuses. If you missed anything or you just want to hear the show over and over again, all you have to do is go to 710WOR.com and there we are, available for podcasts, the Page Publishing Book Club, anytime you want. I'm Alice Stockton Rossini. Think spring, everybody. See you next time.